there is so much literature about the importance of knowledge. But how can I measure knowledge in a society? This is a big question. And how can I put measurements for that? And therefore, based on the measurements, I do regulation. And based on the regulation, I receive proper inputs and be able to give proper outputs in the system.
Is this where we get into trouble sometimes with this lack of holistic thinking, where we have people whose job is to reduce crime, but in order to do that, the acts that they put forward to reduce the crime cause other problems in society, like people can't go out after dark, you can't do. So in order to get crime down, you did damage in another area, other freedoms, and so how do you measure this, but you don't take the time to measure the consequences.
Well, again, that's the antibiotic approach, you know, for the short term, yes, you can say, well, it's dangerous to do this, therefore, you prohibit doing that. That is fine. Long term, though, and holistically speaking, you will need to look at the whole system. And in order to elevate, let's say, the educational status of the society, or the vibrance of the civil part of that society, or the, you know, the alpha culture in the society. How can you measure that? If this is a goal for an alpha person, how can that person measure that so that this charity part of the society is measurable and is controllable? And therefore, we can enhance it in a certain way. It's a challenge.
The systems approach will lead you to a way of analyzing, as you say, where if we wanted to go from 25% crime down to 0% crime, we would rather have 25% crime than to do what it would take to get to zero. They're not a total. It wouldn't be good for society. Would that be systems thinking?
That would be a systems thinking. But it has to be related to the whole somehow. In systems philosophy, we talk about what's called hierarchy. Hierarchy of a system. There's always a hierarchy in any system. Regardless of the postmodern critique of authorities, you know, there's got to be authority in any system. So even if we say that, you know, in a family, the authority has to be deconstructed and all of that, that there's got to be some authority, at least partial authority in some areas that people share somehow. I know that there is an extreme and there is some sort of philosophia, moderation here in the issue of authority. But there's got to be some hierarchy in the system for the system to function. Otherwise, a system that is totally flat is not a system.
There are people who claim that the world is flat.
Okay. How can you...
Thomas Friedman.
Yeah, sure. But it's a matter of... You see, authority is necessary for the functioning of the system.
Even know. The mere example of the Egyptian revolution, it's not driven by a leader.
That is great. But it cannot continue like that. You see,
yeah,
at some point, they have to reorganize themselves into an authority and people and so forth. You cannot really,
govern. Can't be a system. Can't be a system.
It can't be a system, exactly. You cannot continue to govern an 80 million people country from the 200,000 who are staying in the
But how did the world evolve in that direction? Because Egyptian revolution is kind of first of its kind.
Inspired.
Where people take the initiative and go out without anybody, like opposition leaders, dragging them to the streets. Mm-hmm. So what if the world is kind of changing or evolving in that direction where it's going to become a horizontal consistency, not vertical or hierarchical?
I have no answer for this question. Maybe I don't know. We go back to the jungle. You mean everybody is just hunting? Family hunting? Okay, sure.
Professors don't want anarchy, do they? I mean, they used a little bit of anarchy to enact the change, but now they're ready to reconstruct and build another anarchy that's more useful. They don't just want chaos, right?
Yeah.
I think reconstructing hierarchy with justice and freedoms and all of that is a better option than deconstructing and then leaving there. You see, what happened in Egypt, for example, since we talked about that, is a deconstruction, yes, of authorities. All authorities. Nobody has authority over anything. And even now, every company, people are kicking out the manager and, you know, every little... street with somebody who is the, you know, the kind of authority in the street, Sheikh Al-Hara, they call him in the Egyptian culture. Now people are kicking these people even out. Because no, we don't need authorities anymore. It's but really you cannot.
So it's a reaction. I don't think that you can. There's a system reaction.
Yeah, but what I mean is that the consciousness of people is changing. Like they realize that it could be otherwise.
Can
I don't see that example. Yeah, I don't claim that it would operate effectively, but people have come to this thought that it could be otherwise.
Why don't you see the people?
I think after deconstruction you have to go through a reconstruction phase. Deconstruction and full stop is the dream of postmodern philosophers, you know. This is difficult. I'm against that. Systems theorists are against
nature also.
Against nation, yeah, sure. We cannot just be random, you know. Otherwise, we go back to the jungle, and families are hunting and all of that.
Even the jungle, it has
to. That is true.
Oh, the jungle, right?
Little help. Yeah. Well, actually, I have something about that. Yeah, you see, we started by caves and tents and all of that. Yeah, here's hierarchy. Systems theorists talk about hierarchy in that sense. And then we eventually, even with the passage of centuries and time, we eventually move to villages and then towns and cities. And now we're talking about the world as one time and all of that. So that hierarchy, I think, is inevitable. Even if we talk about the world as an entity, under that entity, there's got to be some form of hierarchy.
In the Egyptian example, what's interesting is that they divided themselves. So they divided themselves as Sham and Nom.
That's also true. Even Sham himself in this Tahrir Square, if you follow the links, I've seen a very interesting BBC link. They give you a virtual tour of Medan Tahrir, you know, how they live, how these, I don't know, tens of thousands of people who were in the hardcore there staying there. How they lived for 3 weeks. So they had to do some hierarchy, by the way. They had to divide themselves into somebody responsible for that main stage and somebody responsible for the cleaning of and people in charge of the bathrooms and people in charge of food and doctors and all that. And each person became a minister in their own right. You know, the head doctor was telling people what to do in terms of health. And the security guy, you know, the guys who had these, you know, sticks with them, they had a hierarchy too, you know. They made their own police forces and all that.
Yeah,
so they could not live just like that, 200,000 people in a square.
They made
a
system of their own.
Exactly.
Yes.
So
at that time it's possible.
And now they're starting to actually form, I've heard more than one piece of news, that they're starting to form political parties. You know, they say, okay, now, let's make a party, let's make an association. Now they are back to traditional politics within the hierarchy too. Yeah, exactly. So even if you deconstruct the system because it is not functioning properly, it's unfair, it's unbalanced. There's so much stress in the system. You see, every system has its deficiencies. We're human beings. There's nothing that we will create that is not deficient. But sometimes some systems are too much. You know, there's obviously too much that was happening that the system exploded, and there was so much steam in the system, and there were no valves to take out the steam. You know, so now the system exploded, but it has to come back in a certain way.
Professor, when you study, analyze systematically, and when you study the relationship, we cannot study also, the kind of, let's say, rules that, you know, govern each subsystem and whether they are compatible with the entire, rule of the whole system.
Yeah, we can. But that's the next point, which is specialization. Each of these subsystem is actually aiming at a certain function, a part of the whole picture. So specialization of the subsystems is a feature of the system. you don't have departments where every department is a copy of the other department. I mean, it doesn't work like that. Every department has to have some goal in its own right, part of the big goal, but that's in an organization. The same thing happens with any other system, where even the ecosystem, you have the animal kingdom and the jungle. And this, yes?
I'm sorry to interrupt with that point, but because the ideas come rushing to my mind, and we can compare that to strategic planning in itself. Like, if we think of a ministry, okay, with every department, okay, every department, a subsystem, would have its mission, vision, responsibilities of each subsystem, and the whole subsystem with the whole ministry, they would have, the responsibility of the whole ministry and how it's compatible with the responsibility of each subsystem.
That's great. Okay, that's your assignment.
Actually, it's my internship.
Oh, okay. So it is a real assignment.
Yeah.
Okay. True. Take a systems approach, please. Okay. Multifinality is a feature of having a purpose. Purpose is not something that's pre-programmed. Purpose is something that we could reach from various roads and various approaches. That's by definition purpose. Because if there is an objective, and there's only one way to get to that objective, that's not an objective anymore. It's some pre-programmed thing that is running. And that applies to maqasid al-Sharia, being the objectives of the Sharia, being the purpose of this whole Islamic system. They are achieved in various ways, not just in one way. They might be achieved in one way in a specific environment or a specific background. But they are by definition values that could be reached in various directions and in various forms. And we will talk about that when we study the specific values. That hifdul aqid that I was trying to analyze here, the preservation of mind, is something that is achieved by various things. It used to be achieved by the prohibition of drugs and all of that, intoxicants. That is fine. Now, in addition to that, you need to achieve the preservation of mind via knowledge, via travel for knowledge, via free communication and
free stress.
That's also very true. The psychological side of it. Yeah.
When
the person is stressed, like the cat when the hair is out, I started this in a management course. The guy started to talk about stress. I started talking about this cat where the hair is out, coming up, because the cat is so stressed, it feels threatened. So the hair is, and then he starts to explain how when an employee acts like that, it's very bad for the company, it is really, and sometimes we are like that. We have so much stress, and then we don't have any way of cooling down our stress. And that starts to affect our thinking.
When you mean alternatives, like there can be various alternatives, do you mean means to end?
Means to an end, yes, exactly.
But it's only in the field of Muamalat, right? Only in the social relations. For example, Hifzul Aqid, you said, I don't do Salah, I do yoga, meditation. Yeah? Right.
Yes, thank you. Well, this is a good point. If we're talking about the Sharia specifically, yes, there is a difference between what's called ibadat and what's called mu'amalat. Ibadat, acts of worship, rituals, the ritual side of Islam, versus mu'amalat, which is the practical side of Islam. The ritual side of Islam has less changing elements than the practical side. So, for example, you pray for your heart to be good. You cannot say, well, my heart is good, I don't need to pray. Nobody has ever said that. But you give charity for the sake of the poor. Yeah, instead of giving that charity or whatever, food, I could give them money. I could actually give them knowledge. I could, once we're talking about the dealings of the people, then this is changing. The ritual side is, but let me just complete the sentence. The ritual side is very small though. What is changeable is most of is most of the things that, that form Islam as a religion. What is changeable, not changeable in the opposite, changeable for the same purpose. Multifinality, you see. Achieving the purpose via different means. How do we define an act of ibadah? It's actually a big question. Scholars never had a final answer about it. Some of them said that ibadah, they say ibadah adam ma'kuliyat al-ma'na, that the meaning is not known. I don't know why I pray four rak'ahs for dhuhr and three rak'ahs for maghrib. You know, what's the difference here? So I can't understand the meaning, so I just follow like that. But that definition is tricky, because...
So it's submission.
Submission, if I don't understand the meaning, but maybe somebody else understood the meaning, you see. So that is not true 100%, because sometimes the meaning is rationalized and is understood by some other person. People said the ibadah is what is stated in the script, al-mansus alayhi. But also what is stated in the script is sometimes means to an end. You know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَدُّ لَهُمَ الصَّفَاتَ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمَدَّبَاطِ الْخَيْرِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran talked about the saddles of horses. You know, horses are means to an end. Nobody said that owning a horse is an obligation in Islam. You know, you have to own a horse. And maybe at that time, yes. But now, history changed. And now, we have to go allegorical. We have to go majazi here. We have to understand this according to majaz. So sometimes the means themselves are good for one time, but then they change for some other time. And therefore, they don't become ibadah. So not everything that is stated in the script is ibadah, but that is part of the picture. In the definition of rituals, people said al-maqadir ibadah, you know, whatever is stated in numbers is ibadah. So therefore, yes, I pray four rak'ahs, I go around the Kaaba seven times. But again, not every number is ibadah, because some of the numbers are rationalized. You know, some scholars talked about the numbers in the system of zakat, that these are subject to ijtihad, because they are rationalized. They are not like, for example, the number that is, it's called hadd al-faqr in the fiqh. There is something called the limit of poverty. Now, that limit is a number. Basically, a number of grams of gold in terms of the dollar amount or whatever the monetary amount, then that's hadd al-faqr. My humble view is that hadd al-faqr now is different. Now it's defined by economists. And why do we need to go back to the gold? The gold is not a fixed price anymore. It's you know, in the gambling field of the stock market now. So therefore it goes back and forth. I mean, it went up, I don't know how many hundreds of dollars in the past few weeks. So therefore, that is not, if the hikmah, if the wisdom, if the maqsid was for the gold to be fixed, now the gold is not fixed anymore. What was the purpose anyway? What was the maqsud? What was the idea? The idea is to define the faqir from the ghani, you know, the person who deserves to receive charity from the person who gives charity. Now, so why don't we go to hadd al-faqr as the economy defines it, which is the poverty level, $1 a day. Now, worldwide, we think that a person who earns less than what... I know that this is a bit of a sensitive territory, because now we're bringing some social science and involving it in the sciences of the Sharia. I think that this is inevitable. We have to start to do that if we start to deal with the reality of things. Leave the rituals alone, you know, pray as the Prophet prays, and do the pilgrimage as the Prophet did, and this is the ritual side, the spiritual side of Islam. But once you talk about the society and policy, you have to go rational, you have to go real. You have to really start talking economy and sociology and psychology and so on. You cannot really refer back to the old measures and the old goods and the old food stuff and the old ways and think that you can somehow project that to the current reality. That's not going to happen. Yes.
Let me say the multi-finality situation is on, let's say, evaluation methods of the challenges and opportunities for the system itself to, you know, to survive and attain its goals, you know, given the challenges of the surrounding environment.
Thank you. Good definition. Yeah. Sure. overcoming challenges in order to achieve the same the same purpose.
I have another question. In a system, usually there are inputs and outputs and operation. Mm-hmm. How can we place that in these features?
What do you mean? Inputs and outputs?
Yeah.
And the system itself?
Yeah.
Okay. How can we?
Sorry. I mean, because, you know, when I read the features, okay, I didn't find this element of a system, that the system has input, output, and operation.
Okay.
I mean, how can you derive these things within the feature?
I don't understand.
For example, these features doesn't speak about inputs.
Yes, yes, they do. The transformation of inputs to outputs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this means inputs and outputs and limits for the system, where I'm defining the inputs based on the limits of the system, and whatever crosses the limits of the system to the outside world, that's an output.
Yeah.
Refer to the book, by the way, for more details. By the way, thank you for reminding me of that. I gave you a CD. I don't know, whoever didn't get the CD, please get a copy. It says, Maqasid Public Policy 2011, so far it has these files. I have slides for the first five lectures. Lecture 3 are prepared in Arabic, I would say in English though. So, now, and this is the syllabus, which I will go quickly through before the end of this lecture. If you go to the file that's called PDF, the folder, you will see every required reading in the syllabus. So if we go to syllabus here, so lecture 1 was an introduction. Lecture 2, required reading. Chapter 2, Maqasid Sharia as philosophy. If you go to PDF, lecture 2, or chapter 2 in English, if you open that, you would see the required readings. I know it's a bit of an issue to get the books. These books, though, most of them all of them are on Amazon.com and bookstore, Islamic bookstore, etc., Google Books. But just in case you have difficulty getting there. So you see that this is the table of contents of chapter 2, and then this is chapter 2. So I advise you, if you have any question about that, read chapter 2, email me, or discuss any question you have about that. Now, the next lecture, we have a paper written by Sheikh Al-Tayyib and something that I have written in Arabic on the subject. You will have them here. If you don't read Arabic, I hopefully will help you through the lecture in English. Or I can give you some alternative. I assume that you can read both. If you're struggling with your Arabic or your English, please try to catch up with that, but people who struggle with English will have something to take some advantage of. Then lectures 6 and 7, I have it in Arabic and English because this book is translated. And in fact, my books are translated too, so if you need the other language, let me know. I'll email you back. Some and so forth. So these are the lectures up till 14. In terms of the required readings, I just copied things. I allowed myself to do that within the copyright laws. So I copied not more than 2 chapters from any book, except for my books, which I took permission for. Anyway. So I'm covered legally speaking from the lawyers.
Is that the copyright law in Canada?
I am not sure. That's in Canada. I'm sorry. where my training was. Or rather, that's when I started to observe copyright laws. Before that,
that's when Avery decided to buy the law.
I lived in the Lawless Country for some time and observed so much law. Anyway, so now, lecture 8 and 9, what I was telling you that at some point we're going to have maqasid based decision making and measurability. That's your assignment or project, where I will ask you to apply Maqasid Sharia to some area that you're interested in, that is policy, and write a report and give us a presentation. So that's when we will talk about that. And this will take us all the way to the 14th lecture. We have 15 weeks. In one of those weeks, which is April 11th, I will have to replace that with another lecture towards the end, in which you will present your presentations. So I will not be here April 11th. I'll be in the States for the U.S. Islamic Forum, something I take part in on the presentation. So I saw the permission of our dean, and I will be there in the States. So that week only. Otherwise, we'll be here for every Monday. So this is a total of 15 weeks from now to the end, and these are 14 weeks here. Now, I have these essays and a project, so four essays, 10% each and 25% for those who would like to, you know, do numbers and all that. And the finals, which is usually another paper, take home exam, usually the way I do this. So if you have any question about the syllabus, let me know, please. You have the objectives of the course and the sources and so forth. So I hope that this CD would give you all the resources. From lecture 6 and on, I'm still preparing my slides. So once I do that, I make another CD. It depends on how we move on with the course. Cover the syllabus, back the presentation. Entropy is about, let me finish in a few minutes. Entropy is about disorder. Exactly, if you leave people without order and without making a system, they will tend to have disorder. Like, and any system is like that. A system without order and without energy put in order to regulate it, will tend to move from regulation to anarchy. That's human nature. If I don't have any regulation in my body will disintegrate. If an organization is left without regulations and without checking and without, it will disintegrate. Everybody will stay at home again and do whatever they want. And so forth. So this is the tendency of systems to disorder. And that is something we need to understand about the system, that the system needs order. And the system of a society as well needs order. That's why creating an orderly society is one of the maqasid al-sharia, by the way. حفظ النظام. You know, something that classic scholars talked about too. That one of the high objectives of the Islamic way of life is to keep order in the society and to keep balance between, you know, the different components of the society and all that. Otherwise, the society will disintegrate. And any system that aims at, you know, giving policy and all of that will have to keep this in mind, that without policy, things will disintegrate and disorder. These are systems theories. There are other theories written by systems philosophers. For example, let me cover this. There are several of them you can read in the book. I hope they are not very boring you, but they're very scientific. You see, systems philosophy emerged from science, and now it is part of humanities and social sciences. Every branch of social sciences and humanities now is taking a systems approach or a holistic approach. Yet the language is very scientific. Science as in al-tabi'i, you know, practical physics, science kind of science. The behavior of each element has an effect on the behavior of the whole. We have to believe in a system that anything that changes will change the whole structure. Or will affect the whole structure anyway. And in systems philosophy, they say you cannot pick a flower without moving a stalk. And that is very theoretical, of course, but it's very true that anything that changes in a system affects the whole thing. You cannot really give this antibiotic for the stomach and not expect this to affect, you know, the brain and everything else. So therefore, if we move something, we need to be aware of the implication of that thing on the other parts of the system. That is another systems thinking. The behavior of the elements and their effects on the whole are interdependent because everything is related, everything is connected. Human beings are connected, animals are connected. We're connected to the universe and we're connected to our organizations and our families and all of this. So any change that happens in any of the components will affect the others. This interrelatedness is sometimes hard to see, but it is very important to realize and understand. Because sometimes we fail to see the relationship between an economic decision and the society, and the sociology of the society. Sometimes we fail to understand the relationship between a legal rule that you add, or a policy, and the psychology of the people. And sometimes we fail even to understand the relationship between the psychology of the people. People are happy these days because of whatever happens. That has an influence on your policy, and has an influence on how the system works, and so forth. Interdependence is very important. Now, the subgroups have an effect on the whole, but none has an independent effect on the whole. There is nothing that has an independent effect on the whole society, just by itself. If we understand society as a system, then there is nothing that moves that doesn't shake everything else. We have to see that. If we look at the law as a system, and especially a law in a social context, there is no component of the law that's not interrelated with the other components. You cannot just simply apply, as you know, all of my students that I was telling you about, you cannot just enforce a part of the law and expect the general outcome to be all right without side effects, without thinking about that part that you're enforcing of the law, how it will affect the psychology of the people, and how it will affect, you know, the other systems that are connected to that system, but from the outside, and how it will affect everything from education to everything else. And if you fail to understand the interdependency of the components of the system, then you're not doing good policy. Systems theories could go on and on. I do have a humble proposal for systems theory based on these functions. And these are the functions I wrote about and took a Mafasid Sharia approach. I kind of tried to integrate systems theory with the Mafasid theory in an approach to come up with new perception of the law, a new ethical value system of Islam. And therefore, I integrated my own proposal for systems theory with Maqasid Sharia. I will explain that next time, how these features of a system could actually benefit from Maqasid Sharia and the value behind that in order to make good policy. I will endeavor next time to try to explain that. Multidimensionality, purposefulness, openness, wholeness, but in terms of the law as a system and dealing with the society again as a system, and how the interaction between the law and the society has to be understood within these theoretical frameworks, so that that integration is useful. And I will try to also give some thoughts on how this could enlighten good policy, rather than just applying the law as dry rules without seeing the purpose, without seeing the relationship, and then we end up with that policy. Any more questions? Yes.
I think regarding the future of the topic, I think it offers the space for the system to collapse and compose it decompose its subsystem, and then recompose itself. It's like the space for the dynamic future of a system.
Sure. Yeah, sure. I creative chaos is something that some people propose, and I don't know if this is a good idea. I don't think it is. I think a little bit of randomness is important for the reconstruction, but not total randomness. Total randomness is exactly
partial randomness.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, they say if you would like to change the culture of a society or an organization, or if you want to make a cultural change, you need to shock the society, and therefore people will think that anything is possible, and all of that. Now, if you believe that anything is possible as a society, as individuals in a society, now we can make cultural shifts and cultural changes towards, you know, cultures that are different or whatever. I believe though that this shock of an organization or a society has to be very, very calculated. Creative chaos is, for me, is a very evil theory that does not produce anything, and we are experiencing that are very painful in this creative chaos kind of approach.
Organized shots in some way is a little bit like one definition that we use for intervention.
Yeah, okay.
You have to break the system apart a little bit to improve upon it, but you don't want to break it so much.
Yes.
It causes
so let's end with this innovation.